He'd do well today, but Bo, with a 4-7-10, that's an awful way to start.
The important thing on this pair of lanes, very high scoring, is to keep the ball speed up. Cross lane is a tough spare, 14-1 for the pros, but you have to keep the ball speed up or the ball won't set in the pocket.
Born and lives in Akron, Ohio, home of the PBA. Gallant try, the 32-year-old Tommy Hudson. 19th in the all-time money list, and here's Kingsport, Tennessee, a 22-year-older. Fourth appearance on the Professional Bowlers Tour telecast. Third in a row. Some performance. There it is. Into the pocket. We asked Steve why the success of the modern-day crankers.
I believe the reason that the crankers bowl better is because younger players coming up these days have more knowledge of the game. They realize that lift and turn gets a lot more strikes than just going through the ball.
And by going through the ball, he means straight through it, where the modern player, like such as Martin, lets the hand rotate from 6 o'clock around to 12 o'clock. The fingers in a counterclockwise motion instead of straight through.
Early 12-pin lead. He can increase it with a double here. And does just that. A double for Steve Martin. Leading by 22 pins in Hudson in navy blue and lemon. Ready to go in the right lane after a tough break in the first frame, now shooting in the second. First game, winner to meet Bob Handley. That's more like it. Earlier we asked Tommy about the lane conditions favoring the big hook or the crankers.
Well, the conditions that are conducive to the strong ball are usually the urethane finishes. In other words, the hook more and the strong ball overpowers the conditions, and I think that's better today.
And most of the lanes we bowl on have a urethane base compared to the lacquer base we saw in the 60s and early 70s.
All right. Tommy Hudson on the left lane, where he came up with a split first time. Made a beautiful adjustment now with that double. Trailing by only 12 pins as Steve Martin at 5'6", 170 pounds, is back up. Steve's wife, Kim, is here. Tommy's wife, Barbara, is here. The 2 and the 8, which has been troublesome this year. In our telecast, there's Kim.
Chris, we have seen a lot of 2-8 combinations. The reason being is the sharp breaking hook or the big crank ball, such as Martin Rolls, breaks very late at the back end. And if he doesn't get it started toward the pocket at the right time, it finishes behind the head pin, usually leaves a 2-8 combination, sometimes a 10 pin with it.
Ah, the sleeper 8 was out of there. Steve Martin in the profile replay.
Powerful Steve Martin, 5-step delivery, but notice how he keeps his left arm out directly to balance the rest of his body. Everything in perfect position, then draws that left arm and shoulder back as the right arm comes through. Most people don't think about the left side, but it's very important in a game of bowling to keep your style together.
Finished second 2 weeks ago in the Fairlanes Open, fourth last week in the Long Island Open. Didn't quite finish the way he wanted it to, and he left the 7.
Unusual for the power player to throw that many pins over in that direction. Watch the pin action, the center of the pins, the 5 pin, the second pin that the ball hits after the first, drives right in the 4-7, and no luck. Tremendous pin action. That's where these crankers get the big scores.
And now the Miller High Life Classic winner goes for the 7. Good shape, marking with a spare in the fourth frame, leading by 9 pins. This is our first match, 15th stop on the Professional Bowlers Tour. We'll be back. A duo on today's Wide World of Sports, Harlem Globetrotters, Wood Memorial Horse Race, live from Aqueduct.
And there's the alternate, Jeff Marin, who will have to ask a friend about Firestone. He's not eligible, and he doesn't get another chance on the winter tour.
As we mentioned at the top of the show, all 5 are eligible for next week's $150,000 Classic. The Riviera Lanes in Akron. Tommy Hudson, trailing by 9, has a double working shooting in the 4th. Stuck just to fit at the line on a wobbly 10 will not go down.
What a solid 10. Tommy could have evened the match with that shot, a ringing 10.
Wow.
Hudson with that really, really good delivery that time.
He has a style, though, that youngsters might look at and try to copy.
He's a cranker, but he has a beautiful style. Everything in perfect position. Notice how he hits that foul line, a good follow through, and a good turn.
So it's a spare in the fourth, and trailing by 10 pins. He'll now move to the left side. Left line here at Bradley Bowl. Eighth year here.
Tommy Hudson, who drills as many as 40 bowling balls during the year, likes to experiment with the new equipment the manufacturers come out with. And there's his lovely wife, Barbara, who will be home in Akron. That's their home next week.
A year old Lisa Ann was on her lap a moment ago, but started to fuss. So Barbara put her in the hands of a sitter. Meanwhile, her husband with a strike in the fifth frame. And Martin is up. PBA Rookie of the Year in 1977.
Martin leads by 10. Apparently he wasn't comfortable with something. He had something on his shoe. He actually stepped on some tape down there on the floor that was discarded and stopped to take it off.
You know, our players have the option of being mic'd, wireless microphone, and Steve is wearing one. Let's see if we can hear him from time to time.
Woo!
A nine. Hard to believe.
He should have had something to say about that. That's an unusual hit. That overpowering ball he's using, just cutting right through, chopping the five off the nine.
I have a feeling it was good he kept silent. What he wanted to say, he couldn't say. Well, he showed you how to cover a nine pin and looks to Frank Esposito and Harry Golden, hands in the air like, what can a man do? Well, he can come back and strike now. In the next frame, he'll be shooting in the sixth, the nine pin lead, first match. The winner's opponent is warming up, Bob Handley. Close to the foul line and almost went over it, Bo.
When you're playing that much break on the ball, Chris, you've got to get that ball out of the line. Look at that ball. Almost went off in the channel. In fact, last night in one of the games, Steve threw a shot slightly errant to the right, threw it in the channel, and made the spare. He was fortunate that didn't drop off that time. Watch him lose the ball at the bottom of the swing. Didn't get it all.
1-2-8. Ooh, got it. Spare in the sixth frame as Kim Martin watches. Expecting. And Tommy Hudson,
a man who has really worked on his game, had a little problem beginning of the year with his health. He had the flu and couldn't quite get it together, but the last 4 weeks he's been really sharp.
And with that double, for the first time, Tommy Hudson leads now by four pins.
It's a perfect shot of Tommy Hudson. You can see the trajectory. He laid the ball down on about the 12th board, went out to about the fourth board, then that sharp break at the back end. Perfect strike, driving all 10 pins into the pit. Tommy leads by four, double working seventh frame.
It's our first match live from the Bradley Bowl, Windsor Locks, adjacent to Bradley Field. Waiting to hear first 7:07 today. Come overhead. Oh, but a sort of a spinning two.
Hudson thought he had a strike, but he didn't quite catch it all. We say you'll have to lift the ball to get an effective roll, such as these players do, and that means that the arm has to be close to the body. The wrist and hand roll around the ball just as it's coming off the hand in a long follow-through. Tommy kind of cut the follow-through short that time and didn't get the finish that he liked.
A little right to left to cover the two pin. That was a spare in the seventh frame, a three-pin lead by Tommy Hudson. We'll be back after this. Look at the Bradley Bowl, a vast bowling establishment. We've come here for the eighth year. And here's Bob Handley, 6'1", from Fairway, Kansas, who will meet the winner. Well, you see his hook.
Chris, I think Hanley throws the most powerful ball of any of these crankers on the tour. He has the ball weight rowing towards the pins from the time it leaves his hand to impact 60 feet away.
Here's a man that did lead, now trails by three, a spare working seventh frame.
Oh, gosh.
You know, you heard what he said. 3-6.
I think if there's any one problem that the younger power players such as Martin has, is to see the ball cutting through sharply and leaving the 3-6, avoiding the split, is accuracy. You know, in any game, the basis is still accuracy. It's 90% accuracy and about 10% power, so no matter how much you put on the ball, you still got to put it in the right place.
So Steve Martin of Kingsport, Tennessee, showing us how today to shoot spares. He opened with a double, spares ever since, trailing by five. He'll now shoot in the eighth frame of this first game. Then Bob Hanley, Wayne Webb, and the tournament leader is Mark Roth.
Wife Kim, who's getting used to the television sets being on almost every week. And Martin goes over to the other alternate lane to get another ball. He doesn't like the way this one's reacting, so he's getting one that doesn't hook quite as much.
Still leaves the 10 on the left lane. He is the defending champion, not Tommy Hudson. Tommy won back here in 77, but here is the defending champion. Bo, your 2 years were
74 and 75. I'm almost forgetting now, Chris.
Next year.
Oh, right. Cross lane.
All right. Spare in the eighth. Now Hudson is back up, and he'll be shooting the eighth frame with a six-pin lead and a spare working.
Some good lessons to be learned from these two players. Both power players, good form though, good knee bend, good follow through. But on the spare shots, they throw the ball straight as they can. All you have to do is touch the spares.
Oh, look at the trajectory on that smooth shot. 146 for the seventh, a strike in the eighth frame.
One of the most pleasant women on the tour, Barbara Hudson, Tommy Hudson. Look at those eyes studying that spot. Arm swing right in behind his body. Arm right next to his body, wrist and fingers rolling around the ball. A lot of people wonder where the power comes from. It's the tight arm swing and wrist and fingers as the ball is being released. Hudson could take a 16-pin lead with another strike here in the ninth.
Thanks for that tip, Bo. A seesaw battle. At one time, Tommy Hudson trailed by 22. Now he leads by 16. Martin is up, spare in the eighth, shooting in the foundation ninth.
Hudson going at a 216 pace. Martin, with strikes in the ninth, 10th, and 11th, would be in the 220s.
Hit it! You idiot.
Well, we've heard the 10-pin called a lot of things. First time, an idiot.
That frame was very important for Martin because right now the best he can shoot is 209 if he strikes in the 10th and 11th and 12th frames. That would just force Hudson to mark. Martin with a spare here and a double in the 10th would force Hudson to mark.
Steve's fourth appearance on our tour this year. Third in a row.
Chris, I really like the way that Steve Martin has improved his spare making. Wayne Webb has done the same thing. They're throwing the ball nice and straight at the spares, realizing that accuracy is a very important part of the game.
And another 10.
His third consecutive week 10. You know, in the eighth frame, he went over and got another ball that didn't hook quite as much, and all three shots didn't finish. Watch the sixth pin, the second pin on the right-hand part of the screen. Just lay down in the channel. Doesn't get the impetus and drive into the 10 pin. And that particular shot's going to cost him the match.
So, in this match where we've had only one open frame, that was in the first with our leader, Tommy Hudson.
Very unusual to see a game like Steve Martin is bold. He started with a double and has not gotten another strike since, Chris. A clean game with a double and yet only in the 190s. Not the type of scoring we expected.
Okay.
3-6,
that doesn't matter now.
Well, it's still $4,000 for Steve Martin. as Tommy Hudson with that double up. Martin with only two strikes. So, 33-year-old Tommy Hudson, first time this year on our telecast of Akron, is going to meet Bob Handley. Let's pause a few moments to hear these messages from some of the people who are bringing you this week's stock. Next, Tommy Hudson versus Bob Handley. Pro Bowlers Tour will continue after this message from one of our sponsors and a station identification. And here at the Bradley Bowl, Tommy Hudson with nine strikes, eliminating Steve Martin, 236 to 196. And now it's Hudson against Bob Handley, who won his first PBA title this year. That'll be our next match, and the winner then will meet Wayne Webb. What a field today. Five power bowlers, five hookers, and the biggest guy that moves it from right to left is up on the approach right now.
Powerful Bob Handley, the maximum ball. He throws more ball down to the back end and gets more strikes than any player on the tour.
Watch. Up and in a little bit too much, coming up high, leaving the nine.
He gets so much spin on the ball, Chris, that the ball goes way down the lane before it actually bites the surface. Very similar to spinning a cue ball on a pool table until it hits the side cushion. It doesn't react. The same way with Handley. So much revolution, so much spin that it doesn't break until the last 10 feet. And wow, is it a powerful shot.
Third time on our telecast this year. He won the ARC Alameda Open. Nine pin. All right. He's 6'1", 165. Tommy Hudson, 6'1", 195. If you just joined us, Hudson defeated Steve Martin, 236 to 196. The crowd reacts here with an 8-10 standing.
We've seen every solid tap in the game of bowling except the 7 today. We've had the 10, the 9, and now Hudson's 8. Watch the ball cut right through, chop the 5. The third pin the ball hits, straight off the 8 pin. That's maximum power. Very little deflection on the ball. An unusual hit, but not too tough for the pros.
So it's an even match after one frame, our second match in our live coverage from the Bradley Bowl. Next week, the 16th stop, final stop for ABC Sports on the Winter Tour at the Riviera Lanes in Akron, Ohio. Then later we start this Spring Tour. Professional Bowlers Spring Tour. Five of them. Ten pin.
If Tommy didn't have any bad breaks this game, he'd have no breaks at all. Both shots excellent, the solid nine, the solid 8, and then the swish in 7. Tommy's really bowling well. He's so well practiced, and after winning that first game from Martin, he's loosened up and he's throwing the ball as well as I've seen anybody on TV this year. Keeps his fingers together in the ball to reduce the spin.
What a beautiful follow-through, even on shooting spares here today. Tommy Hudson, now Bob Handley, graduate of Kansas State.
Bob had a sore leg muscle Monday and Tuesday this week, and he didn't even know why it came about, Chris, and he said it just bothered him at all times, sometimes when he's bowling, sometimes just sitting down, and it went away on Wednesday, and he just hope it doesn't reoccur today again.
His first strike in the second frame. As we mentioned, Bob is a teacher. We ask him why he left that profession to go on tour.
I enjoy teaching. However, I had a childhood dream to come out here on the Professional Bowlers Tour. And this year, I have somewhat realized my dream, and maybe someday I'll go back to teaching.
The man, an excellent bowler, and I imagine an excellent teacher, Chris, and he's really coming into his own out here on the Pro Tour. He's using that great education of his and applying it to the game of bowling. He's getting better every week.
Taught accounting, business math, and even typing. Oh, he liked that mixing double. They're giving him an 11-pin lead here in our second match
He's shaking his head, Chris, but I think you get used to those types of strikes. He barely hit the head pin going to the sideboard, wiping out the 2, 4, 5, and 8. What a tremendously powerful ball.
Now Hudson with two spares, shooting in the third frame. First strike after 9 and his first game victory over Steve Martin, 236 to 196.
The trajectory of Tommy Hudson, crossing just outside the second arrow, going out to about the 6th board, then rolling back into the 18th board. That's solid in the pocket. 39 boards on the lane. The pocket solid is the 18th board from the right channel. Hudson was perfect on that shot.
Last June, PBA double champion with Pete Couture.
In winning that championship, they defeated Earl Anthony and Marshall Holman.
We'll be back after this. We're nearing the halfway point of our second game in the Greater Hartford Open, a battle between first game winner Tommy Hudson and Bob Handley of Fairway, Kansas. At the moment, this fellow is leading by 1, can increase it because he has a double working. Handley to shoot in the 4th frame. Amazing the action on the pins as we replay the hook.
Watch Handley's ball. He starts the ball deeper than Hudson, then goes out a little wider to about the 3rd board, then gets all the way back into almost the 19th board, almost a 4-7-10 split. Fortunately, breaks it out.
Shades great of Billy Lillard.
That's the old ball that Lillard made so popular in the 50s when he won the All-Star, the World Championship in the mid-50s. Handley with a chance to increase his lead to 21 pins, 5th frame.
Look how he stalks the line.
Four-bagger for Bob Handley. He finished 3rd after 42 games and now is meeting
Tommy Hudson, who won the first game here on our live telecast, 236 to Steve Martin's 196. Double going, but left the 9.
Hudson didn't get the same good break that Bob Handley got in the 4th frame. Hudson leaving the 9 pin in the 5th. The 2 pin went to the sideboard and tripped out the 4-7, but he got no break on the 9. The one thing that Hudson has going a little bit against him that Handley has going for him is Hanley's got a little more speed, and that helps to carry on the light pins we're using today around the 3-5 pin.
When you say light pins, what do you mean?
Well, Chris, the pin weights that are legal by the American Bowling Congress are 3 pounds, 2 ounces, the lightest, up to 3 pounds, 12 ounces. The average we use on a tour are 3 pounds, 6. But for the pros, a 3 pounds, 5 or 3 pounds, 6 ounce pins is not much of an object to knock down. The pros can handle that very easily. Hudson trailing by 22, 6 frame.
And a moving 8.
The first errant shot that Hudson's had since the first game. Wide, slides by, leaves a 2-8, much like we saw Martin leave the first game. You just leave that. You still hit your spot at the arrows, but you don't get the lift and a sharp enough break.
Body action, hoping to get both as he did, marking with a spare in the 6th frame. Now, Bob Handley, the Kansan, with 4 in a row, be shooting in the 6th frame. The winner of this match will meet Wayne Webb.
Handley's been awesome in his 4-bagger. He's only got 1 ball solid in the pocket. He tripped a high hit, carried a wall shot, was just slapped them all over the place in the 5th frame. Just epitomizes the power that he has on the bowling ball.
Over. All right.
Bobby Handley hits that line very hard. His foot turns almost parallel to the foul line. In fact, it does. And that's just a reaction for the amount of power and whip that he puts with his arm coming through the ball. He got a great break in the sixth frame there, carrying a Jersey squasher, and increased his lead to 34 pins through six. Five bagger working.
By car, we're about 2.5 hours from New Jersey, Paramus, for instance.
Bob Henley, six in a row and a 44-pin lead.
We're going to take a break and then return. Our live professional bowlers tour telecast continues from Windsor Locks, Connecticut. Greater Hartford Open. Man trailing by 44 after winning the first game. Tommy Hudson, spare up shooting in the seventh.
Extremely smooth and effortless strike in the seventh frame as we go to Bo Burton.
Thank you, Chris. With me, Wayne Webb. Wayne, you're in the number two position. That position has not won a PBA tournament this year. You have any reason why that position hasn't been a winner on the tour?
Well, you know, the number one position is probably the toughest, and the number two, you've got to wait almost as long, and then you've got to bowl two games instead of just one. And I think that's the reason, but I've won from the second position before, and hopefully I'll do it again now.
A confident young man thinks he can win from number two, Chris.
All right, and Tommy Hudson not giving up. He has just doubled, cutting Bob Handley's lead now to 34 pins. Two beautiful strikes here at the Bradley Bowl. Handley from Fairway, Kansas. Finished third. That's why he's meeting Hudson, who won the first game over Steve Martin, 236 to 196. Handley with a six-bagger shooting in the eighth frame. Seven in a row. After an opening spare, Handley has been awesome.
And next Saturday, as you look at the score sheet, what a pleasure to return to the Riviera Lanes, meet all the people that we've known for so many years, Bo, for the $150,000 Firestone Tournament of Champions.
The third jewel in today, bowling's Triple Crown, Chris. And, you know, one of the league bowlers there at Riviera Lanes is Tommy Hudson. That's where he got his start. And you know, we have the spring tour coming up, Chris, May 23rd in Fremont, California, then up to one of your favorite towns, Portland, Oregon.
Uh-huh. Five stops all together, including the doubles in Las Vegas. Ninth frame.
Eight in a row. Bob Henley.
Tommy Hudson, who's bowled such a sensational game, is just about out of it. He can still bowl a 246 game, and yet he trails by 54 pins. This really epitomizes the scoring we've seen here all this week.
Three-bagger now in the late stages of this second game, and a 44-pin lead by Handley as we look at Hudson.
Shaking his head, he just did not have any breaks at all. Hudson with taps in the first and second frame. Handley had very fortuitous strikes in the first five strikes he got. Only one solid in the pocket. It's been the difference so far in the match.
1977, Tommy won four titles.
Well, Chris, this is a good warm-up for Tommy Hudson. The Greater Hartford Open is an excellent tournament, but next week is the biggie, the granddaddy of them all, the third jewel in the Triple Crown, the Firestone. And a lot of the players use this as a testing ground to gain some momentum for that tournament, and these two players definitely are in that category. Hudson having a great week, is going to finish fourth, possible 246. Handley, a possible 290, the highest we've had so far on the telecast.
But the seven for Tommy Hudson, one pin less than his first game victory, 236 to 196. Hudson has rolled a 235, but the winner is Bob Handley, who will meet Wayne Webb.
It's all academic. Just Hudson going for the seven pin. He'll have a 235. Just a nice bowling all day by Tommy.
And watching him bowl today, I have a feeling that next week in the prestigious Firestone Tournament of Champions, he'll be right there. All winners competing next week, Bo.
You got it, Chris. A 52-man field.
Wow. An opening spare. Thus far, all strikes for the winner of this match, Bob Hanley. Bob Hanley, a big 289, left the nine pin in the first frame, and on his last shot left the four, a 289 to Tommy Hudson's 235, and now Hanley against tough Wayne Webb, last year's bowler of the year, and that is the semifinal with the winner to meet Mark Roth. Immediately following our telecast on ABC, we'll see what he can do. You can watch it live right here.
Chris, in that race, I like that Noble Nashua with Angel Cardero Jr. aboard. He knows the track. It should be very tough. Interesting race.
All right. There's Webb on the right, now against Bob Hanley. Well, there was a little wide sweeping trajectory on the part of Wayne Webb. We promised you this at the top of the show. Strike for Webb. He'll finish second overall.
What a contrast in personalities out there. Wayne Webb, very outgoing, and Bob Hanley, very reserved, but their bowling balls talk about the same language, nothing but power and strikes.
Bob Hanley, who had 10 strikes in his first game on live television today, and a 289 opens with a strike, so we're all even after one frame.
That 289 bowled by Hanley in that last match against Tommy Hudson is the highest game we've had rolled in a championship round so far this year. Just mirrors the scores we talked about at the opening of the telecast.
And this is the 20th year.
Chris, it's been 7 years since we've had a perfect game. I'll tell you, the setting is out there with the three players we have left today.
Frank and Bob, looking strong, a double. Now Webb, who opened with a strike after waiting in the wings a long time in the number two position. Shooting in the second, strike up.
Interesting graph. No player has won from this position all year.
Wayne Webb keeps it even. Earlier we asked Wayne about having grown up in the New England area, perhaps he's more familiar with the conditions.
Well, I feel as if I have a big advantage here because I know the house real well. I know pair to pair. I know the way the lanes react a little bit better than the other guys, and I just feel real confident.
And what he knows is he knows how the boards are. Like, some pairs hook more than others. We're bowling on 27 and 28 today. He knows that 27 hooks a little more than 28, but he's got a tough opponent in Hanley.
Great appearance in our telecast. He won the Fairlanes Open 2 weeks ago and finished third last week in the Long Island Open. And here is Hanley, his third appearance on our show.
A very warm day here, Chris, and I thought he could be a factor with these players out here, but you know, when you only throw one ball a frame, it doesn't work out very much.
Yeah. Hanley, double up, third frame. Three frames, six strikes.
Look at this ball of Hanley's. We saw him go out to the third board. That time he only went out as far as the seventh board and still kept the ball in play. He's got at least four boards to hit at the breaking point, 45 feet down the lane. And with that type of power, the sky's the limit. If he doesn't get a tap, he should be very close to being perfect.
Wayne Webb, player of the year.
He fouled. He slipped and went over the foul line. That's the second time we've seen it this year. He's still got a strike, but as he pushed off with his right foot, his fourth step, he he drove through that foul line. Remember, we saw his foot turn at an angle at the foul line. Here you'll see it again. Now watch his left foot as he goes into his slide. Normally, he keeps that foot straight and then turns it after he releases the ball. Here it stays straight, then bisects the foul line, setting it off. It's the same as one in a channel. The best he can do is a spare. It's a zero. For that frame, he's shooting for the spare.
So he gets nine.
What a costly error. Unbelievable.
So now Bob Handley started with a three-bagger, trails by 22. The match will continue after this. Gus, disappointment on the face of Bob Handley because in the fourth frame he fouled.
Chris, and what a difference it makes in the score. If he had struck as he did and got credit for the strike, he would have had a 42 pins more than he has now. A foul counts as a gutter ball or a zero, same as missing all the pins. He shot the spare, got nine. As a result, he's only going at a 198 pace instead of a 230 pace. 42 pin difference, possibly.
In all green, fourth frame. Four-bagger for Wayne Webb. Won this championship pair, averaged 218. And what a week he had. Match play record, 20 wins, 3 losses, and 1 tie. Mom and Dad are here from Rehoboth, Massachusetts. Mr. and Mrs. George Webb and brother right behind them.
George is bowled a 300, and Wayne's brother Bill behind him is bowled a 300. Wayne's bowled 300. Some bowling family.
Mixing for strike number 5 in as many frames.
You'd almost think it's lucky. There's the ball out on about the third board, 10 feet from the head pin, and comes sharply breaking in there. Tremendous pin action off the sideboards, and that's the result. That's how they get the big scores. You don't have to bury every ball in the pocket. Use that area on the lane and that powerful ball to keep striking.
Leaving a 3-6.
Bob Handley, when he goes real wide, like he always almost went out to the second board that time, actually goes high in the pocket. When Handley misses to the right, there, you see the ball way out by the channel, the ball goes high. When he keeps the ball a little farther in the lane, about the 7th or 8th board, it catches a little more oil and doesn't go as high in the pocket.
Now for the 3-6 on the right lane. Fifth frame. We'll quickly bring you up to date. In the first match, Tommy Hudson with 9 strikes defeated Steve Martin 236 to 196. Then Bob Handley came out with 10 strikes at 289 to Hudson's 235. Let's see now if he can recover after a foul, which in many cases throws off timing.
And your confidence, yeah, but you start shying away from that foul line. Mm-hmm. That's like a pitcher not following through with a baseball pitch, Chris. It can really be detrimental to your game.
A marginal thud. There he is. 98 through the fifth for the strike in the sixth frame. And 5'5", Wayne Webb is up.
Watch how close he slides to the foul line, Bob Handley. That time he stayed a little farther back, Chris. We had noticed he'd been within an inch, and he almost fouled with his heel again. Very interesting.
He almost does a pirouette at the foul line. One day he's going to spin out.
Two-pin lead.
Wayne Webb, great break. Headpin goes to the sideboard, comes back. And the messenger shot, as they call it on the tour. These power players with polyester bowling balls against these light polyester pins.
Hey, that shook Mom up.
What a great break.
Six in a row, shooting in the seventh frame.
And applause for that six-bagger. And if he can convert the 210, there'll be even more.
Chris, he just gets so wide, he almost leaves a 2-8-10, the shot that you had called earlier in the first match, gets a break and knocks out the 8, but he's still got the difficult 2-10 split. If he doesn't make this, remember, Bob Hanley, with a tremendous string of strikes he can throw, can still make a match out of this. And don't count that man out. He's tough.
Bowling fans love the conversion, especially a 2-10. And, Bo, you professionals, constantly amaze me after 20 years.
That pin 60 feet away, just meticulously perfect on the shot, only a quarter of an inch to play with, and he hits it right in the center. Power and control, that's what makes the top pros.
Practice, practice, practice.
Hanley in a must situation. If he's going to make any match of this, he has to strike here.
A high hit, the 3-6-10.
Completely lost his accuracy. You notice that ball was about the 10th board at the 45-foot mark where he's breaking towards the pocket. The previous frame on the same lane, he left the 3-6. He was out to the third board. You cannot spray it around that wide. No matter how much power you have, you must keep it under control.
Oh, those marginal thoughts after an incident like a foul.
Sure enough, Chris, you picked it right out. Definitely affected his game.
Oh, I think it hits us all, even some incident here where we're broadcasting. If somebody should tap you without you expecting it, it does something. It does something to the concentration.
You're right. 50 pins. Hanley can still bowl a very respectable 228, but he'll never forget that fourth frame. What a pivotal frame. 42 pins down the drain in one shot.
Carmen Salvino at the line with the bowed legs.
Jeff Marin, David Husted, not eligible for the Firestone. They'll have to wait till next year. Bo Bowden, who's won, he's going his first trip. Pete Couture, he used to own the pro shop here at Bradley Bowl. Joe Hutchinson, he'll be going to Firestone. Mattingly Tough. My brother, the Masters champion up there in 12th. Joe Berardi, who won this tournament in 13th place.
What a stroker today, Wayne Webb.
Tommy Kress, who is a world-class ping-pong player, but he finished 14th this week. Dave Beckman right after Tommy Lasko has made it. Don Sylvia, an excellent week. Billy George, steady as ever. Tony Etrio from Fairfield. Ed Ressler will be at the Firestone. Steve Tripp. Gip Lentini got hammered again. The Golden Boy, Frank Ellenberg right in there, and Emmett Schutz round out the top 24.
Wayne Webb is superb. All strikes, and except for one, a conversion of the 2-10 in the seventh frame. Bob Hanley with a strike in the eighth, now shooting in the ninth frame.
Chris, 48 cashers this week. It took an average of 211 to cash and 219 to get the top 24, so you can see how big the scoring was. There were five perfect games rolled this week. Derek Banks, Tony Etrio, David Husted, Gary Schulitz, and Skip Tucker. And the Firestone next week will be a 48-game tournament. 52 players eligible for the Firestone. All the players will bowl 6 8-game blocks. A little different in the format, and definitely a little different in the prize run. 30,000 first.
Three 6-10 for Bob Hanley, who is 12th on the money list this year, over 27,000. And he's bowling Wayne Webb, who is 5th at 43,000. There he is.
And we're going to have a reenactment of some of the pivotal matches as last year that made Wayne Webb the bowler of the year. He defeated Mark Roth in many crucial situations last year to become bowler of the year. It's going to be those two again in the final match here at Bradley Bowl.
So the power crankers can make those spares. Bob will be in the 200s. He's meeting a Tiger. Just the same type of Tiger that Bob was in the previous match with a 289 over Tommy Hudson's 235. Well, didn't matter. It was too late anyway. So it's a 195 for Bob Handley. And coming up next, Wayne Webb against Mark Roth. The Pro Bowlers Tour will continue after this message from one of our sponsors and a station identification. Our 20th year, our 15th stop on a tour of 16 cities. It's been an exciting year. And on our Rolaids tip of the week, we thought we'd go back and relive some of those exciting moments. Here they are after 14 weeks.
The Pro Bowlers Tour tip of the week is brought to you by Rolaids.
22-year-old Steve Martin got the 1981 Pro Bowlers Winter Tour off to a dramatic start as he upset Marshall Holman in the title game of the Miller High Life Classic in Anaheim, California. Then it was on to Las Vegas for the Showboat Invitational, and bowling's biggest stars, Mark Roth and Earl Anthony, battled it out in the championship game. Roth clinched the victory with this strike in the 10th frame. The first jewel of bowling's Triple Crown, the Bowling Proprietors United States Open, was held 3 weeks later in Houston. Marshall Holman, who just a week earlier captured the Quaker State Open in Grand Prairie, completed the Texas swing with a victory over top-seeded Mark Roth. One of the most dramatic matches in PBA history occurred in Toledo, Ohio, in the PBA National Championship. Earl Anthony, shooting for an unprecedented fourth national title, took the lead with this strike in the 9th frame. But as Catherine Schlegel looked on and Earl waited helplessly, the title was determined by Ernie Schlegel's first shot in the 10th frame. Needing a strike for victory, Schlegel came up short, and Anthony had won his third PBA championship over a four-week span. Then as spring arrived in the city of Baltimore, the current PBA Bowler of the Year, Wayne Webb, collected his first victory of the 81 season. With Steve Martin twisting in his chair, Webb needed only 7 pins to secure the Fairlanes Open title. At first, he wasn't sure he had won it, but after a congratulatory handshake from Martin, Webb had no doubts. 40 minutes from the great city of New York, Garden City, Long Island, was the site last week for the Long Island Open. Earl Anthony captured his fourth win on the 81 Winter Tour. He also became the first professional bowler to exceed $100,000 in earnings this early in the season.
We asked Roger.
In Windsor Locks, Connecticut, a suburb of Hartford, Rio, and in the championship match, and it's going to be Wayne Webb going against the tournament leader, Mark Roth. Should be a classic head-to-head live match. And Webb, who shot a 257 to Bob Handley's 195, shoots first. Great way to start.
Chris Roth in a critical match for his confidence. He's been down for the last 8 weeks. This could be a big confidence booster for him going into the Firestone to have a win here today.
Punching it into the pocket, so it's all even. And earlier we asked Mark how important this tournament was as a tune-up to the Firestone Tournament of Champions.
Well, last year I went to the Firestone sick, and this year I'm going to go in coming off a good performance in Connecticut, bowling well. And maybe this will help me through the Firestone next week so I can perform a lot better than I did last year.
And I'll bet it will.
He's got one more game to make it a great performance this week.
Oh, beautiful double. Dead serious, written all over the face of Mark Roth.
And what a contrast to the way we saw him at the U.S. Open, Chris. He was almost lackadaisical in that tournament. Right now, he is down, serious business. Roth has got his game under control in a crucial match.
And a 10-pin for Wayne Webb on the right lane after opening with a strike. If you just joined us, he won the semifinal 257 to 195.
Chris, the week 10, didn't catch it all. You have to lift through that ball straight through. Wayne Webb did not lift all the way through with a good extension and follow through. Therefore, the ball didn't finish strong enough to carry the 10.
All right, a spare in the second for Wayne Webb. 12,000 will go to the winner.
Players have averaged a fantastic 234.6 for the first 6 games, the first 3 matches so far today, and it's going to take a big score to win this final game.
10, the winner of the Fairlanes Open 2 weeks ago and third last week in the Long Island Open, Wayne Webb.
Webb was a bowler of the year by defeating Roth in crucial situations last year, so this could be a deja vu of more to come for the bowler of the year honors. Webb defeated Roth at the Showboat, and he was very strong again at the Firestone. He's the defending champion.
Spare in the third, and now up is a great champion who was finalist in five of our first six telecasts. Some of the other names that have been prominent on our telecast this year, Earl Anthony, eight appearances. That's Jackie Roth, lovely lady. Anthony finished 120th this week. Holman did not bowl. Mark, sixth appearance, and he leaves the 3-10 split.
Jackie has helped Mark quite a bit with his bowling in the last week or so to get his game back on. There's nothing better than have somebody who really knows your game, and his wife knows it very well. Roth with an errant shot. Hooking it too much leaves the 3-10 split. Watch the way he attacks this cross lane with a straight shot and a lot of speed. Excellent spear shooter for cranker or power player.
Just like that. Power to spare. Perfect spot bow to pass along our sympathy to the family of Joe Lewis. I had the pleasure of this man crossing my path. In fact, early days of boxing commentary, he taught me so much. And like his punches, or like Mark Roth's bowling stroke, whatever he said was short and sweet, like too much talk, not so good, great, but we will miss him. But what a legacy.
And he was a great bowling fan, Chris.
Mm-hmm.
Roth playing the inside line. He's the first player we've seen that's playing towards the center of the lane between the second and third arrow. The other four players are playing out near the first arrow and swinging the ball wide. And it looks like Roth's having some trouble with that line, holding the ball out of the nose.
And Bo, I know that he traveled with your dad, the great Hall of Famer, on exhibitions.
Chris, Joe Lewis spent many a day with us.
All right, here in Windsor Locks, Connecticut, we're going to take a break. Roth leads by 8. Stay tuned. Ah, look at him. Bowling a happy Easter and a happy holiday to all of you. We're in our final match, the Greater Hartford Open. Classic match between Wayne Webb, last year's Bowler of the Year, a man that was Bowler of the Year three straight years, Mark Roth. Here they are. Webb shooting now in the fourth frame, trailing by 8. He has a spare working. Leaving a 7-pin.
Webb, no good breaks in this match. Started with a strike, weak 10, swishing 7. Could possibly be a 4-bagger as Mother Wilma, who's a 165 average bowler, and Father George on the right look on. They're rooting for their son. Roth with a conversion here with trail by 9. Webb with a conversion.
Two bowlers who waste no time whatsoever once they set on the approach. This is our final match. Earlier, Hudson defeated Steve Martin, 236 to 196. Then Hanley came on with a 289 to Hudson's 235. And in the last match, Webb 257, Hanley 195.
Webb with that short delivery. He used to stand way back, but since he's held the ball low, he's shortened his approach and ends up short of the foul line.
The man with that punch in his bowling ball, Mark Roth, house professional from the new Madison Square Garden. Well, that one didn't come up, leaving the bucket 2-4-5-8.
Chris, he's just not playing the lanes properly, I don't think, today. He's inside. He tried to overpower that by moving a little deeper in the lane and then turning it a lot. But you cannot skin a cat the wrong way. He absolutely has to move outside, I think, to give Wayne Webb a match.
All right. And Bo, I just have to get in one more comment about Joe Lewis as we look at the score sheet. I think it was best said at Caesar's Palace by the noblest Roman of them all yesterday, Frank Sinatra, when he said, "You came out of the ring with dignity and decency." You know what's fun to work for ABC Sports? Because we have a montage of most of his knockouts, which we use in a lot of our fight telecasts. Most impressive thing I've ever seen in sports. Ten pin for Mark Roth.
Roth getting back on the line. He went a little straighter at the pocket. He's got that really great touch, but he hasn't gotten a break so far this game. A ring and ten. This match is only four pins apart. Roth leading by four.
Looks concerned.
Cross lane. I love the way he shoots spears, Chris. Straight ahead, straight at the pin. Doesn't get any room to miss.
Look at that speed. Post match, it's for the championship.
Wayne Webb taking a little extra time. This is the first time he could take a lead in the match. Trails by four, could take a six-pin lead with a strike. What a great shot he threw. He put everything on it, Chris.
Big double coming at the halfway point. Replay of the shot.
Even in this heat, he can get that ball well out over the foul line with that cupped wrist action. What was the five? Into the 4-7. Key strike. Can extend his lead to 16 with one more. He's got a double working. You know, Chris, even in all this heat, it's amazing how these players can get the ball well out over the line. I think a lot of it has to be attributed to the way they cup their wrist, opposed to 10 years ago, most of the players used to use the flat wrist, and they would lose it in this heat. The cupped wrist power players can get the ball well out of the line. Heat is not a factor.
You mean they have more of their hand on the ball?
Right underneath it.
All right, Wayne Webb with a three-bagger. Frames 5, 6, and 7, 16-pin lead over a former winner here, Mark Roth.
He loves the reaction, 16 pins.
Crossover, leaving the three.
Roth in trouble. He's actually gotten some good breaks. He's been in the nose, been light, and still doesn't have an open frame. Wife Jackie, almost in a hopeless position there, can only sit back there and root for something different to happen. But being lost and confused is very difficult to rectify that in just three short frames.
And the bowler living in Spring Lake Heights, New Jersey. Marks with a spare in the seventh frame. He opened with a double and converted to 3-10 split spares ever since.
Roth has to put some pressure on Wayne Webb here in the eighth frame, trailing by 17.
Leaving a 3-6.
What Roth is doing now is unfortunate, really, in his situation, but there's a good lesson to be learned from this. No matter how great a bowler you are, you have to read the lanes and play them properly. Roth is playing too far inside, too much towards the center. He has to move outside to have anything in this match.
Roth trying to seek his 25th PBA title in 11 years as a member of the PBA. Wayne Webb, 5-year member, 7 titles.
Roth led this tournament by 400 pins, Chris. We saw Anthony lead it by 500 2 years in a row, and the tournament leader has failed to win on this championship round in this particular bowling center the last 3 years.
And this young man's been on a streak in 4 of our last 5 shows.
He can lock it up with another strike. It's not over. Wayne Webb with a spare here would be at a 227 pace. Roth can still have 219. Fourth Webb to mark in the 10th frame.
All right. This is the final match. 12,000 to the winner. Then on to Akron, Firestone Tournament of Champions. And and immediately following our telecast today, live from Windsor Lux, ABC's Wide World of Sports.
Harlem Globetrotters, Go Hollywood, and the Wood Memorial. Prep for the Kentucky Derby, also to be seen here on ABC. The Wood is live.
More like it. Foundation ninth frame strike from Mark Roth.
For Mark Roth, he must strike. As you can see, he's going at a 199 pace. Wayne Webb at a 227 pace. If we look forward, if Mark Roth strikes in the 10th and 11th, he will force Wayne Webb to mark in the 10th. But he must strike on this ball. He cannot win without a strike on this shot.
Ten pin.
See you later. Wayne Webb has again defeated Mark Roth. Roth, the best he can shoot is 199. Wayne Webb going at a 227 pace.
So a man that finished second in the U.S. Open, third in the Quaker State Open, and the Rolaids Open, Mark Roth, going for the 10. Covers it.
Wayne Webb will have broken the jinx of the man winning from the second place, Chris. Nobody in the first 14 weeks has won from that position. Webb proves there is no jinx.
So both professionals, along with 50 others, will be ready for the Firestone next week. The tournament leader in rounds 3, 4, 5, and 6, Mark Roth, meeting a red-hot Wayne Webb. His father stands and applauds because Wayne Webb has won his second tournament this year. We'll be back in Windsor Lux after this. Now the 8th Greater Hartford Open is completed. Wayne Webb has won it along with 12,000. Mark Roth, 7. You see the way they finished, 3, 4, and 5. 227 to 199. Congratulations.
Thank you. I'd like to thank Ken West and the Greater Hartford Open. All the fans, they were really behind everyone all week, and they were great, and I'd like to say hello to Tucson.
Tucson and Rehoboth. Yeah. Ken West is the promoter of the Greater Hartford Open. Ken.
We welcome you as our champion, Wayne, and here's a check for $12,000 and a nice award to keep in memory of the final victory. Thank you.
Thank you.
Wayne, quickly, you're the defending champion of the Firestone. You've broken a jinx here, so you ought to be ready.
I feel good. I'm bowling good now, and looking forward to next week.
What did it mean to have three members of your family here?
A lot. They were really behind me.
Well, I hope you taped it at home so you can see your mother's face and your dad's reaction at the end.
I hope so.
All right. Congratulations again, Wayne.
Thank you.
Once again, the winner of the Greater Hartford Open is Wayne Webb, 227. The pinnacle of every pro bowler's career is to capture the trophy representing the champion of all champions. During this past week at the Riviera Lanes in Akron, Ohio, reporters and news media have gathered to turn their attention to the most prestigious bowling event, the Firestone Tournament of Champions. 52 current PBA champions and past Firestone winners have prepared themselves both mentally and physically over this pressure-packed week. Last night, as the 48th and final game of match play concluded, only 5 bowlers remain in the quest to become the champion of champions.
Hi, I'm Earl Anthony from Dublin, California, bowling's all-time leading money winner and title holder. I'm here to win my 3rd Firestone Tournament of Champions and become the only player to ever do that.
Hi, I'm Mark Roth from Spring Lake Heights, New Jersey. I bowl well the last 16 games of match play to reach the top 5 today, and hopefully I will be able to win my first major title.
Hi, I'm Pete Couture from Windsor Lux, Connecticut. I won my way back into the Firestone by having a good summer and fall last year, and I'm seated 3rd in the Firestone, and I'd like to do like Wayne Webb did last year and win from the 3rd position.
Hi, I'm Gary Dickinson from Burleson, Texas. Last year at this time, I was top seed, and I lost on the TV show to Wayne Webb. This year in the match play, I had 25 strikes in a row, including a 300 game, and I'm looking forward to winning the Tournament of Champions this year.
Hi, I'm Steve Cook from Roseville, California. I came out on my own this winter, and things have been kind of tough, and I've been bowling real well all week this week, and with the victory today, it'll be the greatest thrill in my life.
The 20th consecutive year, ABC Sports presents the Pro Bowlers Tour. Today, the championship finals of the $150,000 Firestone Tournament of Champions. We're live inside the Riviera Lanes in Akron, Ohio, for the final stop on the Pro Bowlers Winter Tour. This tournament recognized as bowling's premier event. Good afternoon, ladies and gentlemen. I'm Chris Schenkel. On behalf of all of us at ABC, we're delighted you joined us today, the 17th consecutive year that we've had the pleasure of covering the prestigious Firestone Tournament of Champions and the championship pair, lanes number 27 and 28. If they could talk, what a bowling story they would tell. So more on that, let's go to my colleague of 7 years, Nelson Burton Jr. Bo.
Thank you, Chris. On this pair of lanes, professional bowlers have won more than $750,000 in the last 16 years. And a great match game pair it is. Lefties have won, righties have won here. There have been some sensationally high scores and some drastically low scores. And it's a great competitive pair to wipe up the 81 season. The 81 season has had some surprises. Just 5 men have dominated the tour. Wayne Webb, Steve Martin, Marshall Holman, Earl Anthony, and Mark Roth. And Chris, it doesn't surprise me today that in the season finale, Earl Anthony and Mark Roth are going for a major title.
How true, and this being the third leg of bowling's Triple Crown, the first was won, the United States Open, by Marshall Holman. Then it was Earl Anthony, the PBA National Championship. And now, one of the five will get this trophy and the third leg of bowling's Triple Crown. $150,000 is the total purse. Today, the five bowlers will be bowling for $69,500. You see the breakdown, $30,000 to the winner. And what a dream match, head-to-head, our first game. A winner of 36 titles, Earl Anthony. A winner of 24, Mark Roth. Stay tuned. After 48 games this week here in Akron, Ohio, that dream match we were talking about on the right, Earl Anthony, who finished fifth in this field of 52 champions, going against the number four finisher, Mark Roth. Earl will shoot first, one of the two left-handers in our field today. He is on the left lane. Shot number one. And leaving a seven pin, Bo.
Chris, Earl Anthony has the experience and not much of an advantage really against Mark Roth, but he's bowled on this pair many a times. He's won this title twice. Mark Roth still looking for his first major title.
And on this pair, the championship pair, Earl Anthony averaged 192. The composite average of the five was 219. For the seven. All right, it's a spare for Earl Anthony, who, well, a man that did sustain a heart attack, came back. He is now 42. He'll be 43 on Monday. Here's 30-year-old Mark Roth, 24 titles, and watch him crank them. And for the right-hander, leaving the 10 pin, Nelson.
Almost identical hits. Mark Roth being the right-hander left the solid 10, Earl Anthony the solid 7. Except Mark tries to shoot his spares a little different than Earl. Mark will move to the left, throw the ball straight and extremely hard. A little better way to shoot it than Earl does.
Right at the bowling return and cross lane. And he blew it. It is an open frame, count of 9 pins, and immediately trailing by 11. Let's see how that will affect his remaining shots.
Chris,
that's a tough break, Bo.
That's the same way he started the U.S. Open. Every time a major title has come around, Mark Roth has seemed to have trouble in the championship round. An easy spare for Mark. He blew the 10-pin first frame.
And he got everything but the 5 on the left line now. He sort of got his dauber down a bit as he came back from the approach. He can't let that happen. We've seen him sort of lose his concentration, Bo, and that's when he's gotten into trouble. A great bowler.
I agree. I think he'll make this 5-pin, though.
Yeah. Good solid hit. And a spare in the second frame of our very first game. This is
the Firestone Tournament of Champions. The winner of this match will meet Pete Couture. The winner of that game will go against Gary Dickinson, and then 6 foot 6 inch Steve Cook, the tournament leader, is waiting. Now, Earl Anthony, spare up shooting second frame.
There's the first strike, and earlier we had a chance to ask Earl how much advantage it is for him with the confidence and experience on this pair.
I think the advantage I would have here is the fact that I've won this tournament twice before. I've been in the position of being under this kind of pressure before, and I've had a great year on TV this year. I've won four other championships this winter, and it looks like it's going to be a good year for me. I have a lot of confidence today.
And if Earl Anthony could go all the way today from the number five position, it'd be $30,000, and it'd be the most money ever won. He has $104,700 to date.
And that big double tightened the screws and going out to a 21-pin lead. You see his son, mustachioed Mike.
Chris, Earl hasn't bowled well on this pair in the earlier rounds, but it really makes very little difference because they get 1 hour practice before airtime on the championship pair. It's equal for everyone.
A high hit averting, however, a split, leaving the 4-7 for the 30-year-old pro from Spring Lake Heights, New Jersey.
The contrasting style between Mark Roth and Earl Anthony, besides being left-handed and right-handed, are the power. Mark Roth, as you see, his ball cut very sharply through the pins, almost left the 4-6-7. He depends on power and scattering the pins. Earl Anthony depends on the accuracy.
So after an open frame, back-to-back spares for Mark Roth, whose seventh appearance in our 16 tour telecasts. There you see the 23-pin lead held by Earl Anthony. Anthony's ninth appearance in 16 shows. Of course, you earn the right to get to this spot. It took four frames for the great Mark Roth to find the pocket. A strike in the fourth. We'll be back with more action live from Akron after this.
...1966 Firestone champion, Wayne Zong.
Tommy Hearns.
Another exciting Wide World of Sports show. That's today. What a fight. What a preview of the Derby. And it's a show that deserves an anniversary special as we look at Larry Laub, sixth place finisher, and mentioning the special, that's tonight at 8 Eastern and Pacific, 7 Central, celebrating the tradition of excellence. It's been a pleasure to be a part of that series. And a pleasure, long number of years, watching this man bowl as he leaves the 7-8.
Chris, Earl Anthony with that smooth, methodical style, five-step delivery, crooked arm, just pushes his ball to the target. He's very smooth. That time he just threw the ball so slow, he actually hit a spot that it broke too sharply at the back end, did not get a good break at all, left a 7-8 split.
And with incredible control of the bowling ball. Came up too much, and there's the first open frame in this pressure-packed first match.
Earl narrowly missing, just by a quarter of an inch, as you saw the sharp break on the ball that Earl Anthony does have. Many people think he throws a relatively straight shot. Earl goes straight down the lane, then has the very sharp break at the back end. That's why he gets a good pin action, and yet can still keep it in play.
You remember how costly Roth's open frame was? Well, this costly for Earl.
With the open, he went from a 21-pin lead down to a 9, which he now holds, and that's how the pros bounce back with a strike in the fifth frame, and he keeps looking up at his wife, Susie, and his son, Mike.
Roth with a chance to take the lead in the match with a double here. Trails by 9.
So at one time, trailing by 23, now he takes a 1-pin lead.
Mark Roth with the style that he doesn't even know. He takes sometimes 5 steps, 6 steps, sometimes 7. But he's in great position as he releases the ball. depends on that powerful wrist action. See, his fingers are going straight towards the pins, almost like a straight ball, but that tremendous wrist snap at the last moment imparts the power that lets Roth be so successful.
Now he'll try for a lead of 11.
And gets it. A three-bagger and an 11-pin lead for Mark Roth, who is making only his second appearance in the finals of the Firestone.
Watch that wrist action loft by Roth on this shot. A tremendous shot. You see that wrist roll right through the ball. The ball lofted about 6 to 7 feet out on the lane when he was really trying to hold the ball back on lane 27. Now has an 11-pin lead.
Strike up.
First match, Duke Couture of Windsor Lux, Connecticut,
will meet the winner in the Firestone Tournament of Champions.
Anthony rolling the ball at the foul line, not even getting any loft at all. The reason a player will loft the ball, such as Roth, that's to delay the hook and play the right side, which hooks a little more than the left. Earl is rolling the ball smoothly at the line so that he can get that nice even break at the back end and not too much slide. Remember, if the lanes are hooking, loft the ball. If the lanes are tight, roll it early.
To a 9-pin lead, a seesaw battle. Our live coverage from Akron will continue after this message. The Firestone.
The 1972 Firestone champion, Mike Durbin.
On the right, the founder of the PBA, affable, incredible Eddie Elias. I was there when he found his bride, Peggy, on his right. Isn't she pretty?
Beautiful couple. Mark Roth trails by 9, has a turkey working, could retake the lead with another strike.
This is our first game. This is live coverage from the 17th Firestone Tournament of Champions. And there's the split. The 4-6-7 for the right-hander on the right lane.
Mark breaking through very sharply, almost left this four frames ago where he knocked out the 6-pin and just left the 4-7. Now he's wide open. Watch the speed he'll use on this shot at the 4-7. Throw it as hard as he can, hope to bounce it out.
So it's the second open frame. Started out with one in the first, now in the seventh, trailing by 24. But remember, one time he trailed by 23 and came back to take the lead. And there's the equipment that does the work.
Chris, that's the behind the masking units, a position that many bowlers don't get often to see. The pin setters that let these players bowl at such a quick rate.
This year, you've seen this man 7 times on our telecast. Oh, 10-pin, and that came in the 8th frame.
Mark Roth seems to be more successful on the left-hand lane. That's lane 27 here in Riviera, strictly because it hooks more. Mark likes the lanes to hook quite a bit. In the left lane, he can play deep inside towards the third arrow and swing the ball wide. On the right-hand lane, is much tighter for the right-handed bowlers. Must go straight at it.
Mark Roth, who earlier this year won the Showboat Invitational, defeating Earl Anthony 253-220. And here they are meeting in the Firestone. Anthony with a 24-pin lead, and now will be shooting in the 8th frame with a 3-bagger working.
Last time Earl Anthony was in this position was the 4th frame. He could have opened a commanding 31-pin lead. He had an open frame to almost even the matchup. Once again, he has a chance to break it wide open here.
Decade in the 70s, Earl Anthony has put together a 4-bagger and now a 34-pin lead as Pete Couture warms up way to the right here at the Riviera Lanes.
Earl Anthony, so methodical, Chris, has it going so well this year, and I think the big reason is, even at the age of 42, is strictly confidence and determination. Earl did not bowl much in 1980, only 18 tournaments. This year he's come back to reassert himself as the player of the decade.
Time money winner has strung 5 with that strike in the 9th frame. $886,000 to date.
Earl Anthony, watch him roll this ball at the foul line. He's playing just around the second arrow. In fact, he went right over the second arrow on that shot. And then the sharp break at the back end gets this wall shot, the 5-6 off the sideboard.
9th frame. Oh, and an up and down game for Mark Roth. Strike in the 9th.
Mark Roth, who has really struggled to win a major title, is in jeopardy of getting knocked out early in the match again. He trails by 44 pins, Earl Anthony in the driver's seat, studying the scoreboard from the official scorer, Harry Golden. And that's all she wrote for Mark Roth, Chris. Best he can do is 192. Earl Anthony, even with a disastrous open frame, would still be in the 220s. So it'll be Anthony and Couture in match two.
So by covering the four pin, he'll be in the 190s. As we'll take a pause a few moments to hear these messages from some of the people we're bringing you this week's stop on the Professional Bowlers Tour.
The Pro Bowlers Tour. This ABC Sports exclusive is being brought to you by Firestone, makers of the 721 steel-belted radio. The Firestone 721, it's one tough tire at a time. By Light Beer, everything you always wanted in a beer and less. And by AMF, makers of the Angle, the world's first and only urethane bowling ball. If you want to be a winner, you've got to have an Angle.
So coming up next here in Akron, Ohio, actually in Fort Fairlawn, Earl Anthony will go against Pete Couture. The Pro Bowlers Tour will continue after this message from one of our sponsors and station identification.
Everyone enjoys bowling.
And here at the Tournament of Champions 1981 version, Earl Anthony with seven strikes has eliminated Mark Roth 221 to 192. So Earl now, along with Pete Couture, hope for a victory toward the $30,000 first prize today. Here is the match. Our live coverage is from the Riviera Lanes, where we've been 16 of the 17 years in the Akron, Ohio area. Match number two, with the winner to meet Gary Dickinson and then Steve Cook. 221 to 192, Anthony defeating Mark Roth. Speed and leaving a seven pin.
Almost the same way he started off the first match against Roth, the solid seven the first time, and what we call the weak seven, where the ball doesn't finish all the way up into the pocket for the second match. Earl, who is a tremendous spare shooter, as all the top pros are, should have no trouble with this. Cross lane.
And so the bowling proprietor from Dublin, California, has opened in the second game with a spare as we look at his wife, Susie. Now Pete Couture. He's 35 years old from Windsor Locks, Connecticut, 5'8", 140 pounds. He had the best average on this championship pair, 232. Here's his first shot under pressure. Close to the channel, and earlier, Webb won last year from number three. We asked Pete what his chances were from that position.
Well, last year's champion, Wayne Webb, qualified in the third spot. He's from New England. I'm from New England. This year, I've qualified in the number third spot. He went on to win, so maybe we can do the same thing today.
Coach Ure had a 300 in round number four this week here in the Riviera Lanes. A double now. Couture against Earl Anthony, and quickly out to a 10-pin lead.
Couture playing that extreme outside line that we've seen quite often this winter, instead of the inside line that Mark Roth had. It shows you how fair this pair of lanes is. Some players are playing in, some are out, some are left-handed. It's just who could perform the best on championship day.
After opening with a spare, has a strike in the second. In his first win over Mark Roth, as we replay the strike, he had seven.
Earl Anthony, excellent shot, knocking all 10 pins in the pit. And Chris, if he goes all the way, it'll not only be his third Firestone championship, but he'll break Mark Roth's season record of winning, and that's for 12 months. Mark Roth set 134,500. Earl could go to 134,700 with a win today.
And only April. Stared at that seven pin. Looks out at the lanes, comes back, looks up at Susie.
Earl Anthony likes to make the adjustment for a light hit by by throwing a little slower. That time he threw the ball very slow and expected to get a little more break at the back end, and it just held there, and he had the same identical shot as in the first frame, the 7-pin.
What a credit to the Professional Bowlers Association, and he, along with Wayne Zahn, were inducted into the PBA Hall of Fame. It now numbers 24 on Monday night at the Champions Dinner, staged by the Firestone Tire and Rubber Company. Now Couture has a double working shooting in the third frame. Avoided the split, leaving the six on the right lane.
Almost had the same fate as Mary Couture looks on that Mark Roth had. He left the 4-7-6 and broke out the 4-7. Pete Couture, very slightly built, slight elbow bend, but locks all the way through. Made a good shot that time, but just let it go too slow.
All right, it's a spare for Pete Couture. There you see score sheet, 9-pin lead by the 35-year-old pro.
Pete Couture likes that outside line. His home house is Bradley Bowl, where we had last week's tournament. And Pete had an excellent week last week, but that house usually plays the extreme outside line, and Pete is very comfortable with it. He was actually disturbed by the ball return has a guide on it. He's talking to the tournament director that guides the ball either to the left lane or the right lane. He's pointing down to that little pointer you see right there in the center of your screen. And what Pete is saying is when he started his approach, it started to move.
It doesn't take much to break the concentration, though.
No, it won't bother him. What he should wait is maybe an extra second before he throws his shot, and that computer will reset that, and it won't bother him on his first shot. It won't move, and it shouldn't move anymore, should I say.
A double and a spare, now the fourth frame. Ooh!
That's as close as you can get to a team.
Oh.
We said Couture is comfortable with that shot, and watch the line he's playing. Right on the very first board, hanging out over the channel. Starts at about the fifth board, goes outside the first arrow, hangs on the very first board, and cuts right into the pocket for a strike.
Cannot be faint-hearted and compete in this sport. We're going to take a break and then return live to Akron for the Firestone after this.
Two-time Firestone champion, Earl Anthony.
One of the neat ladies of bowling, Joe Freeman, owner of the Riviera Lanes, where we've been for 16 of the 17 years for, the tops, the Tournament of Champions. Lovely lady.
She keeps the lanes in such excellent shape, such championship. Earl Anthony wants a re-rack. We've had a minute away for a commercial, and Earl, trailing by 9, wants to take his time, and for some reason there's a lack of communication, Chris, between the front of the bowling lanes and the back end. Remember, a player is allowed one re-rack per game, and Earl asked for it that time.
Wide World today, the WBA World Welterweight Championship, an incredible Tommy Hearns going against Randy Shields, then a Kentucky Derby preview from Lexington, Kentucky. Spare working, a high hit, leaving the 4-7 on the right lane. Got to stay in Akron to see Tommy Hearns against Randy Shields. It's live everywhere except the West Coast.
Anthony going high, breaking up the split, left the 4-7.
For a while, it looked as though it wouldn't come up, but it did. Spare. Fourth frame, capacity crowd, a much sought-after ticket. Like they had standing room only crowds all week as 52 champions, including Nelson Burton Jr.
Thank you, Chris. Earl Anthony, for his appearances this year in the championship round, has averaged 212 for the 16 games going into today, where Mark Roth has averaged under 200 this year on the championship round.
Anthony in 5 frames gets his second strike. And his victory over Mark Roth, 221 to 192, he had 7. Now Pete Couture, who opened with a double, marked with a spare, has a strike working for him in the fourth, shooting in the fifth with an 11-pin lead. He can increase it.
Chris, nobody can forget the ball rolled in the channel by Larry Lobb in this championship round a few years back, and Pete Couture is playing precariously close to the edge of the lane.
Come on.
hit, the winner of three PBA titles.
Chris, we saw him break that up in the third frame. Watch the ball from that outside line. You must trust the ball real wide like Pete did in the fourth to get a strike, but when it breaks through so sharply, the chances of getting a split are much increased. Wide open, much like Roth had.
So from a lead of 11, he's trailing now by one.
It's so important to bowl well in the championship round. They bowled 48 games this week, down to the last five men for the most prestigious title of all, the Firestone. But you must perform on championship day, and that's Saturday. Earl Anthony has been the tops at doing that so far this year.
Pete last bowled in our telecast in 1979, the U.S. Open, when he finished third. That's where he finished here in the TFC. Seven, pin dropping into the pit for a strike in the sixth frame.
And that's the bonus for playing outside, that angle. Watch the five pin rip in behind the seven. Still the two pin comes over and knocks out the seven. Great shot, and I know Coach Earl loved it.
Now, Anthony, who's won this event twice, has a strike up in the fifth, shooting in the sixth.
Gives him an 11-pin lead on her second game.
His opponent, Couture, Windsor Lux, Connecticut.
As the scoreboard shows, Earl Anthony leads by 11, taking advantage of that open frame that Couture had in the fifth. Earl Anthony turning his back, going back to talk to Elias. Wants a re-rack. He couldn't get Harry Golden's attention right away. Remember, players only allowed one re-rack during each game. This is Earl's second, so he has to get permission of Harry Golden.
It's a good chance to thank a couple of 20-year veterans on our telecast. Harry Golden, the tournament director, and our PBA television coordinator, Paramus' own Frank Esposito, and the commissioner of the PBA in attendance today, Joe Antonora.
Anthony with a chance to increase his lead to 21 pins with another strike.
Little body English at the line, but it didn't help. The seven stands, shooting in the seventh frame of the second game.
Chris, Earl in the pocket every shot in the left-hand lane. The first frame of the week seven, the second, third frame of the week seventh, he got a strike in the fifth. And then once again, the seventh frame where he could really put the match in out of reach, he left another seven pin. If he makes this, he'll only lead by 10.
A 10-pin lead for the great Earl Anthony. This match will continue after this.
Two-time Firestone champion, Dave Davis.
This meeting is called to decide which one of us is the most popular light beer drinker of all.
Must be talking about me.
I vote for my buddy, Boog Powell. Oh.
Should I take the minutes?
You can take all year.
Hey, I cast my vote for Billy Martin.
I'll second that.
Me too.
Excuse me, this chart clearly shows what a little showing off can do.
Now, wait a minute. I'm the most popular guy here.
Gentlemen, we a little respect. At least we agree that light beer for Miller tastes great.
Let's Miller taste great! Let Miller taste great!
Better make it a secret ballot.
Could we vote for Red Auerbach? Please.
See what? I'm voting for me.
Count the vote, and that's no joke.
All right.
Gentlemen, we have a winner.
Says here the winner is Bubba Smith.
I knew this was a bad idea.
Light beer from Miller. Everything you always wanted in a beer, and less.
There's not an empty seat in the house. The river are lanes. We're live. 17th Firestone Tournament of Champions. Earl Anthony won the first match, eliminating Mark Roth, 221 to 192. Now he's against Windsor Lux, Pete Couture. Pete has a strike up.
Boy, love that one because that evens it up here at the Riviera Lanes as we go down and hear from Bulbert.
With me, the man who finished second in the National last year and second in the Firestone Bowl. Two great games and came away with no titles. Do you feel like you're jinxed, Gary?
Well, Bo, you know the old saying, if you lead a horse to water enough, he's got to bring some back. And hopefully today, I can take the Firestone home with me.
Chris, this man bowls sensational in championship rounds. He should be tough today.
Well, he knows about bowling and horses because his wife, Helene, who's here, has six quarter horse in Appaloosa. horses with a brand new filly they're proud of. And Pete Couture, who finished third overall, a field of 52, leaves the 10 pin he was shooting in the eighth frame. Let's watch it again. See, not quite as much an outside line. So now he'll back on the approach. He carefully sets his grip and his position on the approach. Look at him. Good way to adjust your color set to the red and blue Pete wearing today. So it's 146 through the seventh, a spare in the eighth. And Anthony Brown is up shooting in the eighth frame, a spare working for Earl, his second match of the afternoon. Strike. And this is our 16th stop in a tour of 16 winter events. 20th year, right here on ABC. Don't forget tomorrow night as we look at Susie Anthony, a 20th year anniversary special. Tonight, rather. That is tonight, and it's 8 o'clock.
Chris,
I think you'll enjoy it.
Coming down to the deciding frames, Anthony leads by one. Ninth frame could extend that lead to 11, right here at a Firestone.
Leaving a seven on the left lane.
And he really thought he had it. You very seldom see Earl Anthony run one out. He usually stays in a prone or profiled position at the foul line. That time, he didn't get up to the pocket solid again for the fourth time in the match on the left-hand lane, has left the seven pin. Has been in a pocket 8 out of 9 frames, and yet he's still going at a 207.
Match number two for Earl Anthony.
Now here comes the first big test for Pete Couture. He trails by one. Would love to have this strike here in the ninth frame to set up the 10th frame. If Couture could strike the 9th, 10th, and 11th, he could actually shut out Anthony. He can be in the 220s. But if he doesn't strike the 9th, 10th, or 11th, we still have a possibility of a tie.
And it's Couture, 35 years old, that opened with a double here. It's our second match. The winner to meet, Gary Dickinson, and then winner of that semifinal to go against the tournament leader, 6'6", 259-pound Steve Cook. Wanted them all.
Almost identical to the shot that Anthony left in the ninth. It's the weak 10 for the right-hander. The ball not finishing all the way up, solid in the pocket. Six-pin laying in the channel, didn't hit the 10. He's in the same situation Anthony was. Cross lane, has to make the spares to stay in the match.
Winner of the PBA Doubles Classic in Las Vegas with his partner Tommy Hudson. And I might add that my colleague, Bo Burton's partner, this spring will be teamed with Earl Anthony.
Should be a tough team.
Unbeatable.
That's our last telecast, June 30th. The situation now for Couture is this. He trails by two. He needs to put some pressure on Earl Anthony. Would love to have this first strike in the 10th.
Pressure. Oh, that pumped the adrenaline.
Peter threw his best shot of the match, and he knew it going down there. He just ripped him apart. Jumping off the approach, now he only trails by two pins. He can take the lead in the match with one more strike. He'll force Earl Anthony to double.
Pete's father, Al Couture, a former boxer, has his name in the Guinness Book of World Records for the fastest knockout when he KO'd his opponent in 10.5 seconds in a 1946 bout. Now he'd like to KO Anthony as Harry Golden, the tournament director, allows the re-rack.
Chris, it seems like for 30,000 in a prestigious Firestone, the eyeballs are squeezed a little tighter together. They're seeing pins off spots or they're moving down there. But it seems like the more the pressure, the more the players are critical of the pin placement. Remember, there's a quarter inch variance allowed by the American Bowling Congress off the spot for each pin. Now, those pins were well within that tolerance, but in a crucial shot like this, Peter wants them exactly in perfect position.
All right.
He needs this strike to take the lead in the match, force Anthony to double.
Anthony won the first match over Mark Roth, 221 to 192. The Tournament of Champions. Thanks a lot.
Peter yelling back at someone in the audience on his way up to the foul line. Somebody yelled out and disturbed his confidence. His shot, Chris,
yes.
He left the 2-8.
He says it's only 30,000.
He has to regain his composure. This match is not over. He only trails by two pin if he makes this. It's important that he make this spare, keep the pressure on Earl Anthony.
Hmm.
Unfortunate that it happened, but things like that in sports do happen. You have to overcome all the surroundings when you're in a match play situations. Peter Couture, unfortunately, affected twice in this game, once by a fan and once by the machine in the second frame.
So he covered the 2-8 and finishes with a 2-0-5
in this crucial second match. Couture with six strikes along the way. Totally upset.
The match not over, Chris. Anthony needs to fill of 19 in the 10th frame. If he would get 18, we'd have a tie. Two frame sudden death, roll off. 17, he would lose. An open frame, he would lose. Couture, nothing to do but contemplate on what has
still
happened so far.
Still a 9.
It's almost justice. Couture would have been shut out if Earl Anthony had struck there. Earl Anthony now must make this and strike to win the match. We have a great possibility of a tie, initiating a two-frame roll-off. Anthony needs the spare and a strike to win.
And we've had roll-offs before in the Firestone Tournament of Champions, and here's a 9-pin. Looks so tiny down there.
So, Bo, what a heavy shot coming up.
Earl Anthony needs a strike to go on against Gary Dickinson. If he gets 9, we have a two-frame sudden death roll-off, much like the 9th and 10th frame of a regulation game. If he gets 8 or less, Earl loses.
So it's on the right lane. Using about 3/4 of the approach, as Couture can only watch. Here it is.
It's a tie.
Well, Earl can't believe it, and only 4 strikes in shooting a 205, and Couture matched it with a 205. So, Nelson, here we go.
Chris, they go immediately into a tiebreaker. They will bowl 2 frames, much like the 9th and 10th frame of a regulation game. Pete Couture will start. He will start on the left lane, bowl 1 frame. Then Earl Anthony will get up and bowl the equivalent to the 9th and 10th frame. Chris, we've had 2 other sudden deaths in the Firestone Tournament of Champions. Wayne Webb in the first year here at Riviera, and he went on to win the tournament. Wayne Zahn, who went on to win the tournament. And Jimmy Stefanich and Don Johnson had a tie, and Stefanich won the tournament after roll-off.
So it's an all-new 2-frame match after a 205 tie. There you see Mary, Pete's wife.
Couture will bowl 1 frame and sit down. This is equivalent to the 9th frame of a regulation game, starting from 0.
Now the 2-5, way to the right on the approach.
Okay, solid spare. Now Earl is up.
Theoretically, Earl can shut out Couture and end the match if he strikes 9th, 10th, and 11th frames. He could shut out Couture, and Couture would not finish. Remember, this is the 9th frame, equivalent to the 9th frame for Earl Anthony, sudden death roll-off, Firestone Tournament of Champions.
He's shaking at the line, but the 6-9.
Earl got a good break and broke down the bucket. He had the 3, 5, 6, 9 standing. Knocked out the 5 and the 3.
Keep talking about Earl's 36 championships, most ever. Must remember he's finished second 35 times.
All even after one frame in this roll-off of our second game, the semifinal to follow. The winner in this roll-off will meet big, tall Gary Dickinson.
We've never had a double roll-off. If they would happen to tie again, as they're even with one more frame to go, this is equivalent to the 10th frame, both players going in even. If they'd happen to tie again, we'd just do it again until somebody wins.
What time's your plane, Bo?
Whatever Anthony does, Couture has to match or better. So it's very simple to keep score at this point. The match is all even. Couture has to match or better whatever Anthony does.
I guess, Bo, this should happen when you gather 52 champions 1 week and head-to-head and bowling each other and then get into the finals live where the pressure is really on.
Anthony, a chance to take a 10-pin lead.
And the two pin on the left lane.
He puts Couture in a must strike situation. Earl with a conversion would have a score of 40. That would be the final score for his two frame roll off. What Couture would have to do is beat the 40. He has a spare up in the ninth.
All right, and now Pete Couture immediately calls Harry Golden, the tournament director. Doesn't like the rack. He's having Harry take a big look at it. Wide World, of course, follows at 5 Eastern and Pacific, 4 Central time after the Pro Bowlers Tour, live except on the West Coast. Great championship fight. Tremendous welterweight Tommy Hearns versus Randy Shields, and a preview of the Kentucky Derby. And then tonight at 8, 20th anniversary special, ABC's Wide World of Sports.
Couture must strike on this ball or he loses. He's back to the same situation he was again in the 10th frame last game.
Well, we're all even up to this point.
Here's the situation. If Couture throws one more strike, he defeats Earl Anthony, goes on to meet Gary Dickinson in the semifinal. If Couture spares, we have another roll-off. If he opens, Anthony wins.
And if you just joined us, Earl Anthony, who defeated Mark Roth 221-192 in the first game, these two professionals bowl to a 205 tie. This is a roll-off, and here's the shot for Couture. Well,
Chris, the pressure got to him. He slipped a little bit, still made a good shot out of it, almost got a strike. If he makes this, we go into another roll-off.
First time.
We'll keep doing this until somebody wins.
Fans, of course, here love it.
Couture must make this spare, though. Don't forget, it's not all. See Couture muscling that ball through, slipped a little bit at the foul line, had enough composure about himself to get through the shot, and almost salvaged it to a strike.
Now he's got to cover this 10 pin. All right. After a 205 tie and a two-frame roll-off at 40 each, we're back to the ninth frame, our second roll-off. What excitement in the Tournament of Champions.
This is the first time in the history of the PBA on any telecast have we ever had a double roll-off. Anthony and Couture, we start all over. Remember, this is, again, the equivalent of the ninth frame for Anthony. He'll lead off the match. It's all even, 0-0. Couture will get up and bowl the ninth, the equivalent to the ninth and tenth frame. Anthony started with a strike.
35-year-old Pete Couture, Earl Anthony, will be 43 Monday.
The shot Couture was looking for in the final shot of the last game, ripping the five into the seven. The head pin coming across off the sideboard, knocking out the 10. If he had carried that one frame earlier, he would have been a winner, but we still have a tie. Both players have a strike working.
Look at Pete Couture. He's run the gamut of emotions today, one of distraught, distress, elation here now. He still has a chance. Cool. cheers. Pete, very simple refrain.
So. Chris, he has the lead. He has forced Anthony to strike at least one time. Regardless of who wins this match, Chris, it'll be interesting to see how much it takes out of them. They still have two more opponents to go through if they're going to win the title.
$30,000 at stake, along with the title.
What pressure stroking here by Pete Couture as Anthony watches. He knows exactly what he has to do.
Couture with another strike will force Earl Anthony to get all three strikes just to tie and do it all over again. This is truly survival of the fittest in Boeing's third jewel of the Triple Crown. Mary Couture looks on, knows her husband's really in the driver's seat now. He has the strikes. Earl Anthony has to get them.
The second two-frame roll-off.
Just like that, he puts together four in a row, this 35-year-old three-time winner, much to the delight of his wife, Mary, and Earl Anthony, who struck in the ninth frame. Wow, in order to tie, he has to roll three.
Reminds me of the game where Dickinson had 300 and Mark Roth 298. It's almost the same situation. He must throw all three strikes to tie the match.
Number one.
Needs two more to tie.
If you just joined us, we're in our second match in the important Firestone Tournament of Champions. Anthony defeated Mark Roth in the first game, 221 to 192. Couture finishing number three, then came in to meet Anthony. They tied after 12 frames, 205, 205. They tied after the first roll-off at 40 all.
To settle for fourth here in the 17th Tournament of Champions. It'll be Couture going against Gary Dickinson.
Firestone. It's been.
Don't miss the special tonight, and we hope you didn't miss, for the first time ever in PBA history, a double roll-off, a tie in the first two-frame roll-off, 40-40. Then Couture strung together four in a row. Anthony on his third shot. But the 4-6-7-8-10 all over. Couture moves into the semifinal against Gary Dickinson. This is the Firestone Tournament of Champions. $30,000 to the winner in the next game and $17,000 to the runner-up.
Couture has a head of steam up. Let's see how much it took out of him to go through that long, strenuous match.
He left the 2, 4, and 8.
What an emotional letdown after going through better than 30 minutes of top competition, a game and a half almost, Chris, even more than a game and a half.
He showed us all what he's made of, because at one point there would be a lot of people that would just quit because he became actually distraught.
So here in his second game, Pete Couture, after winning a double roll-off against Earl Anthony, the great Earl Anthony, has a spare in the first. Now,
Gary Dickinson, 6'4", 180 pounds. He's won seven PBA titles. He was the runner-up last year to Wayne Webb in the Tournament of Champions.
Smooth as silk.
If there are any two players on the right-hand side of the bowling lane that play that outside shot as good as these two players, I don't know who they are, Chris. Gary Dickinson, who loves that outside shot down and in, and Pete Couture, who was born and bred on it at Bradley Bowl in Connecticut.
There you see Pete working on the holes in his bowling ball. Just hanging on the line, and here, 210. Oh.
Dickinson playing about the same line that Couture is, outside down the first board, very near close to the channel, and he just hung too wide that time. He went out to the very first board, and he leaves the 2-10 split, a very common split, actually, when you play that outside line.
There it is. For the pros, 4-1. So, after opening with a strike, it's 28 through the second frame here in our semifinal match. And Couture, the man who bowled 4 in a row in the second roll-off to defeat Earl Anthony, marked with a spare in the first, now shooting in the second. All but the 10.
Couture with the hit that was actually the winning shot for him against Anthony, ripped the 10 out on that particular shot, left it in the second frame of this semifinal match. It doesn't seem like it took anything out of Couture. He's in good shape, Chris. He should be able to go all the way if he can win this match.
So for those eliminated as a result of head-to-head competition, Mark Roth earned $5,000 in this year's TFC, and Earl Anthony, $7,500. The loser of this match will get $10,000. But the winner will go into the finals against tournament leader, and that is Steve Cook, largest man in the PBA membership. And don't miss the 20th anniversary special of ABC's Wide World of Sport, 8 Eastern and 7 Central tonight. Through the second, and a strike up in the third for Couture.
Gary Dickinson, who has bowled so well over the years, has never really had a tremendous lucky streak in the championship round. He's bowled well. There's Helene, who just flew in this morning. Gary went up to Cleveland to pick her up. Has bowled so well in the championship rounds many times and has never really come away with any great breaks.
This is 10 pin on the right.
Starting right off where he left off last year against Wayne Webb. Gary Dickinson, 6'4" with that great profile. Watch this locked arm swing. Open shoulder. That's the amount he's going to swing the ball out over the lane. Locks that elbow, closes that shoulder, and really one of the great styles. Someone to emulate if you want to be a top player.
So that is the second open frame in 4. Helene.
Chris, Gary Dickinson uses a two-finger style to shoot his spares. In other words, he pulls out one of the fingers. Now, when the lanes are fairly slick, as these lanes are today, that ball has a tendency to slide a little more than usual. And in both shots, Gary's problem was he didn't get the finish on the ball that he wanted.
And there's the second strike in 4 frames. With 2 opens back-to-back for Gary Dickinson, a 22-pin lead by Couture. We'll be back.
The 1976 Firestone champion, Marshall Holman.
Pete Couture's shot in the 5th frame. Leaving a 4 in the 5th frame, he left a 7, marked with a spare in the 4th. So he's shooting now here in the 5th, and he's the man that lasted through 2 roll-offs against Earl Anthony, stringing 4 to defeat Anthony. So now he's against Gary Dickinson in the semifinal match of the Tournament of Champions. The winner of this head-to-head game will go against Steve Cook. 2 5th-place finishes this year for Gary Dickinson.
Dickinson, with open frames in the 2nd and 3rd, has a chance to close the match down to just 11 pins with another strike. He has to be asking himself, Chris, when is it going to stop? He bowled so well last year, the ringing 10 almost robbed him of any chance to win the title last year. Once again, to get back in the match, he throws an excellent shot, solid 10. Watch that two-fingered style. See, just one finger in the ball.
Well, his wife, Helene, can relax on that frame, marking with a spare in the 5th. And it's a 21-pin lead for Pete Couture.
Dickinson is stylist by all means, does almost everything by the book, takes his time, has excellent concentration, has really been his top star for the last 10 years, just hasn't got the recognition sometimes that he deserves.
There it is, getting a strike in the sixth frame in this pivotal match for the Firestone Championship. As Couture is up, he has a spare working, he'll be shooting in the sixth frame.
Show you how important it is to carry. If Dickinson had carried that solid 10 in the fifth frame, Couture would be come up here leading only by one pin. As it is, after five frames, he still has a 21-pin lead. Six-frame semifinal match.
Despite a slight distraction, Couture went to the line and marked with a spare in the sixth frame.
Seems like that last match between Anthony and Couture has taken something out of everybody. The crowd and everyone seems just abnormally quiet right now. Couture in the driver's seat has a strike up, can extend his lead to 31 with another hit.
Looking away.